If you answer a fool with his own stupidity, he will think he is wise. Do not answer a fool with his own stupidity, or you will be like him. Whosoever uses a fool to send a message cuts off his own feet and brings violence upon himself. From Proverbs 26. Our hymn this morning, "It Is Well With My Soul."
The scriptures teach that as Christians, we've been crucified with Christ, and therefore our lives are not our own. In fact, we live this life by faith. And sometimes that faith is severely tested. There's a hymn called "It Is Well With My Soul." It was written by a man named Horatio Spafford. He was a wealthy lawyer from Chicago. And in 1870, he lost his only son to scarlet fever. A year later, the great Chicago fire broke out and wiped out nearly all of his real estate assets. Then a couple years later, the economy took a dive and he was even more affected financially. In order to help boost the family spirits, he sent his wife and four daughters overseas to attend a rally by D.L. Moody. At the last minute, he wasn't able to go because of some business concerns, and so he sent them and he said, "I'll meet up with you shortly." Well, halfway across the Atlantic Ocean, their boat was struck by another vessel and it sunk to the bottom of the ocean. When Horatio Spafford's wife, Anna, got to a place where she could telegram him about the incident, her message only had two words: saved alone. His four daughters drowned in the accident. He was obviously devastated, and as he boarded a ship to sail across the ocean to meet up with his grieving wife, he spent many hours on the bow of that ship, looking over the edge at the waters that had claimed the life of his four precious daughters. And when he got to about the spot where they perished, he penned these words: "When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well with my soul." That's really the same message that Peter gives us in 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 19. He reminds us that sometimes we're going to suffer according to the will of God. But when we do, we're supposed to entrust our souls to a faithful Creator. If our faith is strong enough to do that, we'll be able to say, like Horatio Spafford did, "Whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well with my soul."
Will you please rise?
When peace
is well
like a river, and attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, and
the cross.
is the day when the faith shall be signed and the clouds be rolled back as a scroll and the trump shall resound
and the Lord shall descend
and even so it is well with my soul. My soul, it is well, it is well with my soul, with my soul, and it is well, it is well with my soul.
Please remain standing and bow with me as we go to the Lord. Dear most gracious and holy Father, from many directions we are hearing that you are a fairy tale best left to the minds of children and that our enlightened society would be better off when we finally grow up and come to acknowledge that you do not exist. All around us, fools are making plans for our future and those plans do not make room for your direction and guidance, your love, your morality, or your desires for our lives. We have come to live once again in the times we read about from the Old Testament where from every corner of our society, the powers to be make no room for your Godship and the Lordship of our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son. Men will lead men and nations and they will not make time to hear your voice or instruction. The time is here when the serpent, so beguiling as in the Garden of Eden, hisses his lies as truth into the ears of all who will listen. Your truths are twisted and forgotten. All effort is made to bend our wills, to desert your laws and your truths and your direction. The fools around us pressure us to following after our own lusts and our own desires, as they do. Lord, we need strength in these days to make the hard decisions to stay on the correct path. We need minds to unravel the twistedness of the serpent's tongue around our ears and find the truths you have written in your holy word. Help us to find those truths. Help us to stand upon those truths. Give us strength to stand for the poor and helpless and widowed. One day you will return, and in that day we will have to answer for all that we have done. Every knee will bend, and every head will bow, and the serpent's tongue will be silenced forever. Hear our prayers this morning. Accept our humble worship. Encourage our hearts and embolden our wills that we may be pleasing to you even to the end of time. For it's in the name of our precious Lord and Savior Jesus Christ that we pray. Amen. Amen. You may be seated as we go to Jesus' name above all names.
Redeemer.
Lots of reading this morning comes from Psalms 3, 4, and 5. I call aloud to the Lord.
And he answers me from his holy mountain.
I lie down and sleep.
And I wake up again because the Lord continues to support me.
Amen. And bless the reading of God's word. Who doesn't believe that you wake up because the Lord is the one who supports you? Amen. Right. All right. So we have a praise hymn this morning. It's a new one. And we've got our kids that have worked coming here to sing. So let's go, guys. It's I Will Trust in You.
Letting go of every single dream, I lay each one down at your feet. Every moment of my wandering never changes what you see. I've tried to win this war, I confess. Tomorrow brings, there's not a day yet you have not seen us. So in all things be my life and bread. I want what you want, Lord, and nothing less.
When you don't move the mountains, I'm needing you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could walk.
Guys, good job. Our memory verse this morning is from Romans 3:23. Here we go. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God,
Now that's a pretty simple one, and by now I ought to be able to take it off the screen and say, what does Romans 3:23 say? Amen. All right. Good morning. It's good to see everyone here this morning, and it's good to see you that are at home watching at home as you do. It's nice to be here in the house of the Lord this morning, and it's just a wonderful day, and we've got a great sermon coming your way as well. But I'm really pleased, and the kids and the young people, they work hard to sing to you. It's, you know, you forget, you know, that there's a lot going on there. They're overcoming fear, and they haven't done this before, and so I'm really proud that they come, they get up, and they rehearse, and they do that. So, and we're going to do more things, and they as they get older, they're going to keep doing it. They might even, one of them may even replace me one of these days. So anyway, it's good to see all of you that are watching from home and from the area. And I want to make sure that you know that Wednesday Bible study, and you can bring a lunch, counseling. I've been filling up sometimes, but I do have some times available. So give me a call at the 967 number. I think that's on the bottom, 967-3628. That's 814 area code. Our kids program Wednesday, and I understand that Thursday the kids are going to be trick-or-treating this week. We thought it was going to be Tuesday, but we found out this morning that it's going to be Thursday. So we might not have a kids program on Thursday because they all might be out trick-or-treating or getting ready to trick-or-treat. And again, you know, our needs are out there. We're still needing some more Sunday school workers, and we still have our GoFundMe page out there. We're trying to get people to donate because Christmas is coming around the corner, and it's a lot of stuff going on here at the church, I have to admit, though I wish I didn't have to admit, but the money's a little bit tight this year, we want to make sure that the Santa Claus comes, I guess, and that the kids get a blessing for the Lord. That'll happen anyway. So anyway, if you want to donate to the kids for Christmas or for their activities, please send us a Community Bible Church, P.O. Box 41, Titusville. All right. Any other announcements that need to be made? Potluck today. What are we having, kids?
Tacos!
Oh, I'm sure that everybody heard that. They like tacos. So it's Taco Sunday here at the church, and they're going to have a great time. Any praises that we have going on? Anybody have a praise? Yes, Jordan.
My cousin got hit by a car, and he's in the hospital, and he's in pretty bad shape.
Okay, so that's a prayer request, not a praise, right? You're not saying you're happy that he got hit by a car.
No,
okay. So, all right, praises this morning, yes.
My mom's finally out of the boot.
Your mom's finally out of the boot. Well, that's a praise. Destiny is here this morning. That's a praise as well. All of you kids and all of you here that got on the bus, get up early. Because they got to get up. And we have breakfast Sunday morning at 9 o'clock. So the pastor's got to get up at 7 o'clock or get up at 6:30 to get out here to the church to drive the bus. Gene's got to come and drive the other bus. We got two routes so that neither one of us die in the process and getting the kids here. And we got a whole slew of kids over in Children's Church this morning. And then we have tacos. That's a blessing. It's always a blessing to stop by the houses and see the kids because they're, you know, we're trying to break the habit of doing things late on Saturday night so you can't get up on Sunday morning to worship God. And that needs to be a pattern in our life for the rest of our life so that until the Lord comes that we know that Sunday morning, Saturday night, we got to be good so that Sunday morning we can worship the one who loves us the most. Anyway, any other praises this morning? Yes, Gene.
One of the cheapest times I've ever gotten out of there.
All right. Yeah, you know, God has a way of working on that. I know we have our good friend over here, Samuel at Ag Tire, and he came in and was knocking and smelling and said, "Gene, take it over and look. They may not be able to fix it, but boy, those people are really good at finding problems." And so, because they have to work on tractors and stuff in the mud and stuff that breaks down for the farmers. And sure enough, he comes back with a big smile on his face and says, "It's a sending unit. They don't have the proper tool for it." So he goes and finds out that's it and got his truck back. All right. Praise the Lord for that. Anyone else this morning? Elizabeth's praising the Lord. She's here for Taco. Another Sunday. Getting close to 91. So doing well. Walking around. And so praise the Lord for that. Anyone else? All right. Now, Jordan, you want us to pray for your cousin? Cousin. All right, and the Schaefer family, because a lot of stuff going on there in the Schaefer family.
It's really a sad time for the Schaefer family.
Uh-huh.
Shut down camp,
all right. Well, it's about that time. Anyone else this morning have a prayer request? Yes, Mike.
My sister boyfriend's grandmother's died.
Your sister's boyfriend's grandmother died, okay.
Well, she's
Oh, in the process of dying. Okay. All right. Anyone else? I'm glad that we pray for other people. Yes.
Last weekend, my mother gave me a ring that my grandmother was wearing when she died. And yesterday, I lost it.
Oh, no. Okay. So pray for Rory finds her grandma's ring. All right. Haley. Your mom had cancer, and we were praying for your mom, and
she has to go through a little bit more,
therapy, and that she's been doing well, and we praise the Lord for that, and we'll keep Haley's mom in prayer as well. And you that watching us at home, we know that the Lord knows what's on your heart, what you need. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for watching over us. We thank you for our church. We thank you for all of our kids. We thank you for our congregation. We thank you for this country that we live in. And we ask you to be with all the leaders of this country, to be with our military and all of our officers and everyone who wears a uniform and serves one another. We just thank you that they're there, that as General Kelly said this week, which I thought was most inspirational, Lord, these people aren't required by any law to do this. They do it out of the goodness of their heart. So, Lord, they deserve our prayers. They would deserve our respect. And watch over them as well. Help us to be the country that we've always been, that we can continue to be a Christian nation where we can spread the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Be with all of our kids as they go to school, and especially this year, this time of year with the trick-or-treating, that no harm will come to any of our kids. We ask you to be with Jordan's cousin who was hit by a car, and we ask you to be with the Schaefer family, and we ask you to be with Haley as she and give her some insight to find that. We thank you so much for Haley's mother getting better, and we ask you to be with her as well. She needs more chemo and that. We ask you to be with those members of our congregation who were ill this morning. Sue's out with bronchitis, and we just ask you to be with several of the of those, Melissa and the rest that are out sick this morning. And I thank you, Lord, that you helped me get over this cold that took forever, it seemed, to get over. Be with those that are at home. Some of them are sick. Some of them are invalids. Some of them are have prayers that they need your help with. We ask you to, and we, with our congregation, together with those who watch us at home, raise all those prayers up to you, because we know that you're a God who sits on the throne and answers all of our prayers. We ask all these things in the name of our precious Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Our hymn, Face to Face.
Face to face with Christ my Savior. Face to face, what will it be? When with rapture I behold
Of Ezra. We did up through chapter 3 last week, and today we're going to do, and it seems like a lot, it probably is, but chapters 4, 5, and 6. And because it's a story, usually it's Sarah that comes here and tells the stories, but it's this time I get to tell a story. You kids should really listen to this, because it's a wonderful Bible story. Ezra 4, 5, and 6. When the enemy of Judah and Benjamin heard that the people who returned from exile were building a temple for the Lord God of Israel, they approached Zerubbabel and the heads of the families, and they told them, "We want to help you build because we worship the same God you worship. We have been sacrificing to him since the king Esarhaddon of Assyria who brought us here." Well, but Zerubbabel and Jeshua and the rest of the heads of the Israel's families told them, "It isn't right for your people and our people to build a temple for our God together. We must build it alone for the Lord God of Israel, as King Cyrus of Persia ordered us to do." Then the people of that region discouraged the people of Judah and hired counselors, that's attorneys, against them and made them afraid to continue building. They bribed officials to keep the people of Judah from carrying out their plans throughout the reign of King Cyrus of Persia until the reign of King Darius of Persia. When Xerxes or Artaxerxes began to rule, the enemies of Judah and Jerusalem wrote a letter in which they made an accusation against the inhabitants of Judah and Jerusalem. And then you have these three people. Bishlam, Mithridat, and Tabeel, they were part of the bad board, and the rest of their group wrote to him when Artaxerxes was king of Persia. Now, the letter was written with an Aramaic script and translated into the Aramaic language. Rahab, the commander, and Shimshiah, the scribe, wrote another letter against the people of Jerusalem to King Artaxerxes. At that time, Rahab, the commander, and Shimshai, the scribe, were with the others of their group. the people from, and then it gives all of these, then Tarpai, Persia, Babylon, Shusha, they were all from the people of Elam. That's people on the other, on the east side of the Jordan, between the Jordan and the Euphrates. And the rest of the people whom the great noble Assurbanipal deported. Assurbanipal settled them in the cities of Samaria and the rest of the lands west of the Euphrates River. This is a copy of the letter that this bad board, or the bad people, sent to the king. It says to King Artaxerxes, from your servants, the people west of the Euphrates, Your Majesty, you should know that the Jews who came to us from you are now in Jerusalem. They are rebuilding that rebellious and wicked city. They are close to finishing the walls. The foundations are already in place. You should also know that if this city is rebuilt and its walls are finished, the Jews will no longer pay taxes, fees, and tolls. Ultimately, this will hurt the king's income. Now, because we are paid by your palace, it isn't right for us to watch something happening that will dishonor the king. So we are sending this letter to inform you that you should search the official records of your predecessors. You will find in those official records that this city has been rebellious and has been a threat to kings and provinces. This city has a history of rebelliousness. That's why this city was destroyed. We want the king to know that if this city is rebuilt and its walls are finished, you will have nothing left of your province west of the Euphrates River. Then the king sent this reply. He said to Rehum, the commander, and Shimshai, the scribe, and the rest of their group, that's that I talked about before, from Elam, living in Samaria, and to others west of the Euphrates River, I wish you peace and prosperity. The letter you sent me has been read word for word in my presence, and I gave the order, and a search was made. And I discovered that the city has a long history of uprising against kings. Its inhabitants are guilty of treason and rebellion. Jerusalem has had powerful kings who have ruled the whole province west of the Euphrates. Taxes, fees, and tolls at that time were paid to them. So order these men to stop rebuilding. Keep this city from being rebuilt until I give you the order. Be careful not to neglect your duty in this matter. Why should I, the king, suffer any more harm? Rehum, the commander, Shimshi, the scribe, and their group hurried to Jerusalem after getting a copy and hearing of this letter from Artaxerxes, and they forced the Jews to stop rebuilding. Then the work on God's temple in Jerusalem was stopped. Nothing more was done until Darius' second year as king of Persia. The prophet Haggai and Zechariah, grandson of Iddo, prophesied. That is, that they gathered the people. They were their priests, and they prophesied. They preached to the people and the Jews in Judah and Jerusalem in the name of Israel's God, who was over them. Then Zerubbabel, who was Shealtiel's son, and Jeshua, who was Zodak's son, began to rebuild God's temple. In other words, they preached and told the people, don't worry, God put us here, go back to work. And so God's prophets were with them and supported them, and their pastor was with them and told them it was okay for them to go back to work. At the same time, Governor Tattenai from the province west of the Euphrates River, Shethar Bozani and their group went to the Jews and asked them, who gave you permission to rebuild this temple and finish its walls? They also asked the Jews for the names of the men who were working on this building. But the leaders of the Jews were under God's watchful eye. They couldn't be stopped until Darius received a report and sent a reply to it. That was Haggai's position. Yeah, we can begin work, and they'll have to write Darius again and get a letter back. And here is a copy of the letter Governor Tattenai from the province west of the Euphrates River, Sheth Bozani and his group, the Persians west of the river, sent to King Darius. They sent him the following report. To King Darius, we wish you peace and prosperity in everything you do. Your Majesty should know that we went to the province of Judah, to the temple of the great God. The temple is being built with large stones and with wooden beams laid in its walls. The builders are doing an excellent job and making rapid progress. You hear the serpent's tongue hissing in the back. with the colorful language. We asked their leaders the following question: who gave your permission to rebuild this temple and finish the walls? For your information, we also asked them for their names so that we would have a record of the men who were their leaders. This was their reply to us: we are the servants of God of heaven and earth. We are rebuilding the temple that was originally built by many years ago by the great king of Israel. But because our ancestors made the God of heaven angry, he handed them over to King Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon, a Chaldean. So Nebuchadnezzar destroyed this temple and deported its people to Babylon. However, in the first year of the reign of King Cyrus of Babylon, Cyrus gave permission for God's temple to be rebuilt. In addition, Cyrus took out of the temple in Babylon the gold and silver utensils that belonged to God's temple. Nebuchadnezzar had taken them out of God's temple in Jerusalem and brought them into the temple in Babylon. Cyrus gave them to a man named Sheshbazzar, whom he had made governor. Cyrus told him, take these utensils, place them in a temple in Jerusalem, rebuild God's temple on its original site. Then Sheshbazzar laid the foundation of God's temples in Jerusalem. The temple has been under construction from that time until now, but it still isn't finished. If it please your majesty, this is still a bad board. If it please your majesty, because they didn't believe this letter existed, and they were kind of deriding those who, you know, saying that these people were lying. But if it please your majesty, allow someone, please, to search the king's archives in Babylon to determine whether King Cyrus ever gave permission for the temple of God to be rebuilt in Jerusalem. Then please send us your majesty's decision on the matter. Then, chapter 6, then King Darius gave the order to search the library where the archives were stored in Babylon. A scroll was found in the palace of Ecbatana, which is in the province of Media. This was written on it. Memorandum. Date: Cyrus, king. First year of king. From King Cyrus. Subject: God's temple in Jerusalem. The temple should be rebuilt as a place to offer sacrifices. Its foundation should be laid. It should be 90 feet high and 90 feet wide, and with three rows of large stones and a row of wood. The king's palace will pay for it. In addition, Cyrus took out of the temple in Babylon the gold and silver utensils that belonged to God's temple. Nebuchadnezzar had taken them out of God's temple in Jerusalem and brought them into the temple in Babylon. They should be returned to their proper place in the temple in Jerusalem. You should put each one in God's temple. So Darius decrees and scolds, and he says the following things. Verse 6, Governor Tatnai, from the province west of the Euphrates, Shethar-Boznai, and those of your group, the Persians west of the river, you must stay away from there. The day of destruction was over. Don't interfere with the work on God's temple. Let the governor of the Jews and the leader of Judah rebuild God's temple on its original foundation. I am issuing this decree about how you must help the Jewish leader rebuild God's temple. The cost for this should be paid out of the king's own money from the taxes on the provinces west of the Euphrates. That was their money that they were using for other things, now has to be sent to Jerusalem. Full payment should be made to these men so that the work is not interrupted. Also, whatever the priest in Jerusalem need for burnt offerings to the God of heaven, bulls, rams, lambs, wheat, salt, wine, and olive oil should be provided for them each and every day, and make sure that nothing is omitted. Then they can offer sacrifices that please the God of heaven and pray for the life of the king and his sons. I am also issuing a great decree that if anyone tampers with my order, that person should be impaled on a beam, torn from his very own house, and his house should be turned into a pile of rubble. May the God whose name is worshipped there cause the downfall of each king and nation who tries to tamper with my orders or tries to destroy the temple of the God of Jerusalem. I, Darius, have issued a decree. It's to be carried out exactly as I have ordered.
I bet you young people, guys, don't think stuff like that's in the Bible. But it is. Wonderful stories about sin. The next time the temple is destroyed, it comes from the Roman Empire hundreds of years later. And we know from our history that even Rome met its downfall. And it may be because they violated this decree that God had asked Darius to decree. That any nation that would tear down the temple would be destroyed. And that actually happened later on. So we must know from this that God has a very, very good and long memory, and he doesn't forget anything. This is an interesting story because it's a real story, and it shows how God takes care of his faithful. And it's outside of Israel and inside. It's in a Persian history as well. All too often we get scared and afraid, and we fear those bullies around us. In our fear and shuddering, we forget to turn to God. The bad people here had gone to the good people, the Jews, and told them they had to shut down their work because some rogue board had elected themselves to end their mission. Well, the fact of the matter is that it was God's property, and he will have the last say on the matter. Don't be discouraged. Don't be afraid. And don't let fools ruin or run your life. Opposition to the rebuilding program did not come from the inside, but from a rogue board from the outside, pretending to be from the inside. I will have occasion later on to call attention to the fact that not only two tribes returned to the land, Judah and Benjamin, but all 12 tribes actually went back. These people are saying that they returned to the promised land during the days of Esarhaddon, king of Assyria. It was Assyria, you remember, which had taken the northern tribes captive. Some of these people apparently had trickled back into the land and had mixed with the Samaritans. As a result, they wanted to join up with those who had come back from Babylon. The enemy's first effort to hinder the work of rebuilding the temple or the church is to offer that somehow they are allies and that they are legitimate. That has always been the subtlety of Satan in his work. Here, the adversaries of Judah and Benjamin, the rogue board, said, "We have been worshiping God here all along, and you folk have just gotten back. Let us join with you, and we'll worship him together." That sounds very good on the surface, but these people were not genuine. The rogue board were not genuine. Zerubbabel and Joshua and the rest of the chiefs of the fathers of Israel said unto them, "We have nothing to do with you, and you have nothing to do with us." The chief fathers of Israel were not very nice, were they? They absolutely rejected the enemy's offer to become allies. The Israelites do not seem to be interested in the ecumenical movement. That's the one world, one church, one body. They don't seem to be interested in that. Boy, they must be bad. In fact, they seem actually rude. But the very interesting thing is that they were right. The important thing is to be right. When the psychological approach comes in conflict with the Bible must always prevail. Their worship was some weird practice that wasn't pleasing to God. So God sent in another group with instructions to worship him properly. Then the people of the land weakened the hands of the people of Judah and troubled them in their building and hired counselors against them. That's the rogue board. Insisted they knew the law, so they hired attorneys to frustrate the purpose of rebuilding the church or the temple. These people were nothing more than troublemakers. As soon as they were turned down, things didn't go their way, they began to hire attorneys and gather whatever power they thought they had and actively oppose those who God had legally sent to rebuild the temple. They weren't interested in building. They were interested in making things turn out for their own very private interests. They wanted the house and the church all to themselves. So this rogue board decided to compose a letter to the king of Persia with a false accusation against the remnant that had returned to rebuild Jerusalem. They filed a lawsuit and composed dubious legal documents in opposition. Their argument was that Jerusalem was a rebellious city and that Artaxerxes will have trouble with it again if he allows the city to rebuild. So the king of Persia took their advice. He searched the records to see if their accusation was correct.
when this letter comes back from the king of Persia, the so-called friends, I call them the rogue board, hurriedly bring the letter to the building site and wave it in front of the people to gloat. Now, when the copy of the king Artaxerxes' letters was read before Ram and Shimshon the scribe and their companions, they went up in haste to Jerusalem unto the Jews. And by force, they attempted to stop them from building. They thought they had won the battle. They were so excited and full of joy, they even gave an eviction notice to cease and desist and stop the work. But the faithful who trusted in God, instead of running away, turned to God. And by turning to God, like Paul Harvey, I always loved Paul Harvey, and Paul Harvey always had this thing, and now the rest of the story. Because when these things happen to the faithful and God and godly, there is always a rest of the story. The people not only stopped building, they were also tempted to walk away from the entire project. They felt this would be the best way to solve their problems. They didn't want to be fighting with other people who were calling themselves brothers. There are many people who feel that if they could just change their location, they could solve their problems. But that is not always true. You can't run away from your problems. Fortunately, this time the people did not run away. Instead, they reached out to God, and God raised up a pastor, a prophet, Haggai and Zechariah. These two prophets or pastors were called upon by God to encourage the people to resume building the temple. They checked the law and were sure that the law would eventually prove them out to be the correct one. So instead of giving up and wandering off and waiting to see, they encouraged the people to go back to work, doing what God had brought them there to do. So the people went back to work. When work was resumed, the rogue board of enemies heard about it. They go to the governor and another high official and demand they challenge the workmen. They say, "What's the big idea? You were ordered to stop building. Why are you still here building?" Now, the answer that was given is really not an answer at all. To begin with, Tatanai and his crowd are enemies. They are men of the world, and the world is probably not going to hear that the answer is that God told them. But that is the real answer. God really did tell them. The secret of the Lord is with them that fear him. The natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him. A fool is a fool according to his folly. In fact, they answered by questioning a question. Then said we unto them after this manner, "What are the names of the men that make up this building?" In other words, "We didn't see your names written on the list of congregants that was given to us. You have no right to interfere or even to ask that question of us." So they didn't stop the work. They continued working on. The wonderful thing is that you can depend on God to keep his eye on those who are his own. So off goes another letter to the king. This is another letter the enemy gets off post-haste. I think he sends it probably special delivery. "Be it known unto the king that we went into the province of Judea to the house of the great king, which is builded with the great stones, and timber is laid in the walls, and this works goeth fast on and prospereth in their hands." As you can see, the thought is in the letter is this: we didn't go up there specifically to spy this out. We are really not their enemies. We just happened to be in the neighborhood and stopped by for a little visit. And to our horror, this is what we found. And oh, the lies our enemies can spread. So it comes down to that the Jews finally had their day to be heard. Well, they actually had their day to be heard because the bad people, the rogue board, listed the erroneous reasons the good people were claiming as their permission to build. Now, I want you to listen and take heed in what I am about to say, guys. Every dog has its day. But bad people and rogue boards can and will come against you, especially if you are doing what God has instructed you to do. It will always happen. But there will always come a time and a day and a place where God will have his day. Me, I want to be on God's side. And if you have been faithful, that day may come through you.
These enemies did not believe that the decree had ever been made by Cyrus, but the letter is saying that the Jews claim of such a decree is the basis on which they are rebuilding. So they ask that the search be made. They are certain that no such decree exists, but that these people are doing this all on their own. They are building and doing all this hard, expensive work all on their own. The Jews were in the place God wanted them to be in. They were in the land. However, their condition is not so good. They are discouraged. They would like to walk completely away from the whole business and the whole project. It was an expensive, hard-as-nails project, and they weren't getting many attaboys or pats on the back either. So God had to raise up someone strong enough to continue to encourage them to keep building and working. It seems that God's people today tend to get their position and condition mixed up. If you are in Christ today, you are safe. Your position is good. But how is your condition? Are you a discouraged saint? Are you anchored in Christ with a sure salvation? But you want to give up and quit. Do you want to walk away from it all? If that is how you feel, although your position is good, your condition is bad. That was the state of the Jews in the book of Ezra. And just as they become the most discouraged, voila, a discovery is made. This is the part of these things I love the most, where the enemy gets hoof and mouth disease and his foot is caught in his mouth, and that he should have kept quiet. But notice what happens. Then Darius the king made a decree and search was made in the house of the rolls where the treasures were laid up in Babylon. Can you hear the trumpets of the cavalry coming, right? They're back in the old west and a cavalry is on his way. Darius asked for a search. Someone was ordered to go down in the basement somewhere and dig up old archives which were covered with dust. And there was found at in the place where the scrolls were kept in Media roll there, and it was written in the first year of Cyrus, the king of the same Cyrus, the king made a decree concerning the house of God at Jerusalem. Let the house be built, and as we read before, and also let the gold and the silver and all that stuff be built. It was all recorded there. All of this is unearthed by King Darius. He never would have known about this decree if the enemy had not mentioned it. This was a real blunder on the part of his enemies. They used the very language. They expected to destroy the Jews in Jerusalem, but it was used to destroy themselves. But what happened was that language was the very instrument that was used to destroy them. Now, this is the message that King Darius returns to Tattenai. Tattenai was the governor with an important job, and he thought he could stop the building of the temple of Jerusalem. But when the decree of Cyrus was located, the present King Darius realized that it was the law of the Medes and the Persians, so it had to be obeyed, and it could not be altered or changed. So he makes a further decree. He says, now look, not only are you to stop hindering the work, you are to help it along. You are to keep the taxes that you gather for yourselves over there on that side of the river. And instead of keeping them or sending them here to Persia, you are to give the money to these people for the rebuilding of the temple and that which they have need of, both young bullocks and rams and lambs and for burnt offerings, wheat and salt and oil and all of that stuff, according to the appointment of the priests which are in Jerusalem, let it be given to them. I mean to tell you this. Rogue board must have been furious. Not only were the Jews allowed to rebuild, but now the rogue board and their fellows were ordered to buy the state to go out, collect money and animals to pay for it. Darius also decreed to serve penalty upon anyone who would hinder the work. Here's our problem. We do not trust God, and we do not obey God. And we think God is off somewhere playing golf or fishing, so we get scared off and easily frightened. There are bad and evil people in the world. Bad rogue boards and groups and committees out there led by Satan, just waiting for the Christian to let his guard down. God, our Father, and Jesus Christ, our Lord, have told us so repeatedly.
Paul reminds us and we're told by God and the Lord Jesus Christ. The remedy is, and the safe place is always the same. Always being faithful to trust God and obey God and do what God has sent us to do. Here and now, it is to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ without exception. We must learn to trust and obey. And that is our hymn of dedication this morning. When you get down and out, turn to God and trust in Him.
When we walk with the Lord in the light of His Word, what a glory He sheds on our way. While we do His good will, He abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey.
Offering person come and take the offering? Will you please rise? Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Dear most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for your strength. We thank you for surrounding us in your love and holding us in the palm of your hand. Help us to have the courage and the strength that we need to do the work that we need to do here. Be with all of those that are watching from home and lift and raise them up. Give us all the opportunity to live in a way that's pleasing to you, to live in a way that brings others to you. We ask you to give each of us the opportunity to witness to someone this week, to invite someone to church, to invite someone into our home to watch the service, to invite someone to Bible study or youth group or all the things that we do here. Give us each the opportunity to spend some time this week in the Bible and read and study and to show ourselves approved. Watch over us and guide us. We ask you to bless this offering, and we ask you to bless all of those who give, not only just of their tithe, but of their offerings of time and effort and energy and talent and prayers and all the many things that go on here every day of every week. Lord, me. Especially ask you to be with our young people, to keep your hand upon them, to watch over them as they go to school, to guide the teachers and those who give them instruction, that they will be raised up in a proper way and receive good instruction. We ask you to be with their parents as well, to keep your hand upon them, to watch over all of us and keep your hand upon us all as we go this week, upon our houses and our homes and our cars and our finances and our church and all that we have. Be with us and guide us. Be with those at home as well. Give us the courage to live as we should be living. We ask all these things. In the name of our precious Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.